you make us new. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away.
Christians, join to sing.
Come, Christians, join to sing.
Be seated. Your attention, please, to the baptistry. Pastor?
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see all of you here today. We have a very special observance of believers' baptism this morning. I'm going to go ahead and ask Shannon and Paul to come and stand with me here in the baptistry. This is a very special, come on down. Yeah, this is a very special day for them. Not only are they getting baptized, but they're also getting married today. After the service is concluded today, they're going to get married over in the chapel in a small service, but you're certainly welcome to be a part of that. And we just rejoice in the way that the Lord is working in their lives and how He's stirring in their hearts and their family and how God has brought them to us here. So, Shannon, let's start with you. It's right here. Shannon, is it your profession of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Upon your profession of faith, I baptize you, my sister in Christ, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Be buried with Christ in baptism, and raised to walk in newness of life. Turn around, Paul. That's in about an hour, Paul. Paul, go ahead and go this way. All right. Paul, is it your profession of faith that Jesus Christ is Lord of your life?
Yes, sir.
Upon your profession of faith, I baptize you, my brother in Christ, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. Y'all come right here. Shannon, you come. I got wet on that one, brothers and sisters. It's kind of cool. It's kind of cool water. Let's have prayer, and then Vince is going to come welcome us officially. Lord, we thank you for this day. This is a special and exciting day for this new family. Lord, we thank you that they are now our brothers and sisters in the kingdom. And Lord, we also thank you that very soon, even today, that they are going to make sacred and solemn vows before you and before each other. And Lord, we are so grateful to be a part of that and to be a church family for them today and for these next weeks, months, and years. Help us to disciple them in the faith. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Vince.
It is good to see everybody this morning. We are so thankful you chose to get up this morning and to get ready and come to Sunday school, then come into worship service. I am Vince Smith. I am the minister of families here. We'd like to officially welcome you. We'd also like to welcome those that are watching via live stream or those that are watching KIDY on the television channel, as well as those listening in on the radio on the Cool 100. We'd like to thank you again. If you're a guest here in the sanctuary, in the seat back in front of you, there is a connection card. If you could fill that card out for us, drop that card in the offering plate. It is just a way for us to connect with you and you connect with us. By no means will we harass you. We probably will contact you and thank you for coming today, but if you could do that, we would greatly appreciate it. We also like to thank those. This last week, we got a chance to go over to the freshman campus and feed the teachers and the staff there lunch and had some potatoes and some chili. Greg Bauckham, wasn't that chili good? It was good. He was testing it beforehand. I had the cookie testing down. He had the chili testing down. All right. We were set. All right, but we want to thank those that help provide food, that help to serve. As in the words of Bill, it was a win, definitely. It was a great opportunity for us to minister to the staff over there. But God is good, and we're so thankful for our church to serve in so many different ways, in different capacities. Why don't we take a moment and greet one another, and we'll continue to worship. Children, start making your way down. Hey, quick question. Does anybody here have your driver's license?
No.
No. Well, I might need a ride after church. You do? You got your driver's license on you? Good. Has anybody driven a car before? Whoa. We are on television here. So, toy car. A go-kart, okay. Quick question. I have some signs here. I need everybody to look up. I need you to tell me what these signs are. I have a driving test coming up. All right, and I have to do these sign tests, and I need you all to help me study. Can y'all do that?
Yes.
All right, listen, I got to pass this so I'm not driving illegally, okay? Let's do this, all right? So what is this one? Tell me.
Stop sign.
What are you supposed to do when you see this?
You stop.
Oh, okay. Okay. That makes sense since it says stop, right? Who wants to hold that? Someone will hold that. KP, you'll hold that one. All right, what about this sign?
Caution.
What does this sign mean?
Be careful.
Be cautious.
Be cautious. I like it. Be cautious.
What
does it mean to be cautious?
Be careful.
Be careful? Does it normally mean that there's either a rough road or maybe some workers around?
Or maybe a dip.
A dip? Yeah, that's good. That's
or
good. Here you go.
A dead end.
That'd be good to be cautious of a dead end. All right. What about this one?
Yield.
What is?
Stop and let the other
people. Yeah, you have to yield to other traffic, slow down sometimes. Okay, sometimes it's like a rolling stop, you know. Sometimes I've learned that people don't.
I have.
All right. All right, so who wants to hold that for me, Mason? Thank you, sir. All right, what about, this one might be a little tougher. I don't know which one, it's that way. It's a turn. It's a specific type of turn. Anybody?
U-turn.
That means you can make a U-turn. And what does that mean when you do a U-turn?
U-turn.
You turn completely the opposite way. You do a 180, in essence. Who wants to hold that one for me? All right. What about this one?
One way.
You can only go one way on the street. All right. I'm going to make a confession. Where we came from in Florida, we didn't have many one-way streets. It goes our second day here. I might have went the wrong way on a one-way. Someone was honking at me, and I just waved right back at them, thought they were just being friendly. Can you believe that? I'm sure glad I didn't get a ticket for that one. You hold that one for me? You remember when that happened? Yeah. Hey, what are these signs called? What are these images called? Signs, they're specifically called traffic or road signs. Do you know that God, you know, if we think of our life as a road trip, all right, if we're going to take a road trip, we have to abide by these signs, right?
Yeah.
You know, if not, you get a ticket or you could get hurt, even worse. You get someone else hurt, have a car wrecked. But same thing, you know, God gives us road signs for our life if our life is like a journey. Where do you think we find those road signs?
Everywhere.
Downtown. I'm talking about for our walk.
In
the town. What about with our as a Christians? What would be our road signs?
Go to Tom Green County.
Tom Green County. We find our road signs in the Bible, right? You know, the Bible gives us some instructions. In Psalm 119, all right, it's verses 57 through 60, it says this: "The Lord is my portion. I promise to keep your words. I entreat your favor with all my heart. Be gracious to me according to your promise. When I think on my ways, I turn my feet to your testimonies. I hasten and do not delay to keep your commandments." You know, in the Bible, there's a lot of things that say of how we should live our lives. And, you know, the best way to find a roadmap to our life is first to look at, you know, the experiences we've already had. You know, sometimes we make bad choices, sometimes we make good choices. But when we match those choices, those good and bad choices of what the Bible says, that equals our roadmap to life. You know, if you come and you made, you know, sometimes we get stop signs when our life comes, and that means stop what you're doing. Maybe then right after that, we get a U-turn. God says, turn completely around and go the other way. Or maybe God says, hey, guess what? In the Bible, it says there's only one way to heaven, and that is Jesus. Just like the road sign fell. Sometimes we slow down. So the Bible is our road sign or our traffic signs of life, and we have to be mindful of it in our lives. Can we do that? Think so? That requires us to read on it. It requires us to meditate. It requires us to memorize some scripture so we can follow it. Let's pray real quick. Heavenly Father, just thank you for today, God. Lord, I thank you for your word, God. I thank you for all the children we have here today, God. Lord, I thank you for your word that is, it is our traffic sign, our road sign to life. Help us to follow it. Help us to guide in it, Lord. Lord, most importantly, just continue to keep these kids safe. Continue to grow them up in your name, Lord. Lord, we just love you so much and praise you in Jesus' name. Everybody said?
Amen. All right, let's go. Scripture tells us we all come to God through faith by His grace. So this morning, no matter what we're feeling, accepted or rejected, we come just as we are. Sing this song with us. Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner. No sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Here's what he tells us. Lay down your burdens. Lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face.
So lay down your...
Our lives, and the truth is that we can never, ever be the same again. Declare this with us this morning.
I will never be the same again. I will never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path. I'll same again. I could never return. I close the door. I will walk the path. I'll run the race. And I will never be the same again. Call my fire, soar my race. God.
Scripture with me. Arise, bless the Lord your God forever and ever. Oh, may your glorious name be praised and exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are the Lord. You have made the heaven of heavens with all their host, the earth and all that is in it, the seas and all that is in them. You give life to all of them, and the heavenly host bows down before you.
Let's pray. Our Father, in the very stillness and quietness of this great room, we pray that you will hear the prayers of your people, that like the old prophet Nehemiah, that we lend our voice to the host of giving praise and blessings to you. Our Father, we also know that this is a time of giving, and that is something that each one of us as an individual must bring to you. Father, we do not come to you empty-handed. So we pray that as you taught your disciples that day, when you pointed out to them the dear widow lady who was giving all that she had, and some would say today, why would anybody expect someone to give all that they have? Lord, we give what we have. We give sacrificially. We pray that you'll be with us today. Our pastor, he brings a message that we all need to hear, and these things we ask in your son's name. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, the 9th chapter, the 62nd verse. Jesus replied, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God."
Thank you again for this beautiful day. Thank you for the baptisms. Thank you for the wonderful time in worship today. We pray that you would help us now as we now engage the scripture. Help us to find hope and meaning and encouragement in it as we learn how to move forward by living backward. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask a favor real quick. If you're listening on a hearing device, if you would turn that down just a little bit. It's feeding back, and that's kind of distracting. So if you would go ahead and turn those down just a little bit, that would help me a great deal. All right. Today we're going to talk about moving forward by living backward. Moving forward by living backward. One of the greatest ways that you can move forward in your Christian life is actually by living in a backward way. Now, some of you are looking at me like I'm a crazy man. So let me define what I mean by the word backward. Backward living is the way of Jesus. Backward living is the way of the kingdom. Let me give you an example. Jesus said, "Love your enemy and pray for them." That's backwards, isn't it? I mean, in today's world, what is the notion today still on how to treat an enemy? You hit me, I'm going to hit you harder. Right? Jesus said, "Love your enemy." Jesus said, you know, when you pray and when you fast and when you give your tithe at church and your offerings and when you're in a worship service, you don't have to make a big deal about that. You don't have to know all the lingo. You can even get your clothes wet. I mean, what a concept, getting wet by getting baptized, right? It's okay. That's backwards though, right? Because we want an experience. We want a show. We want to use all the right spiritual lingo, all the right religious lingo, so that we can look spiritual but not religious. That's the way of the world. Jesus' way is salt, light. A.W. Tozer is a great theologian. Was, he's with the Lord now. Great pastor. He said it like this. It's better than I can say it. Let's put that up on the screen. Go to church once a week and nobody pays attention. Worship God 7 days a week and you become strange. That is backwards living. Let me take a line from Jesus. Whenever you live backwards in today's world, you will plow straighter. Why is that? Because you're not looking back. I mean, this is an ancient phrase, actually, that Jesus is using here. Did you know Jesus didn't make this one up? This actually goes back. He's quoting a man named Hesiod. He was a Greek poet who lived back in about 600, 700 BC. This illustration is as ancient as that man. If you're plowing a field and look back, what's going to happen to your field? It's like when you're driving today. Don't do this, but if you're on the loop and you're distracted by something in the back seat, what are you going to do? You're going to drive in the direction that your hands go. I mean, scientific fact, your car will go the direction that you take the steering wheel. Right? So you may end up at a guardrail. Don't do that today, as distracting as things can get in the back seat. If you look back, you will not move forward. If you're plowing straight and look back, you're not living backwards. Now, with this in mind, let's do a little bit of soul searching today. Because this teaching from Jesus is one of those texts that really has less gray in it than others. This is one of those all or nothing texts from Jesus. Either you plow forward and look back or you don't. So what I want to do in the next few moments is talk about some situations that we all face, even in my own personal experience, and I know that you've experienced some of these things, ways that we look back that hinder us from moving forward by living backwards. There are some ways that sometimes we live our lives that we want to move forward, but yet we still, it's so tempting to look behind us when we're plowing a field. So I want to talk about some of these things, and then I have some encouragements for us. But there are a few ways that we fail sometimes to move forward by living backwards, because we're looking backwards. What are some of those things? Here's one. Epic failures. Epic failures keep us looking back. Some of you may be here this morning, for instance, and that voice in your mind, remember we've talked about that before, we all hear voices. That voice in your mind says, you are of no use to God anymore because of blank. You fill that in. I know what it is for me sometimes. What is it for you? That voice that says, God cannot use you. You did this. You don't look right. You don't have the right friends. You don't talk the right language. And you know, the devil loves this one because a lot of times he'll get you thinking about something that you did back in like 1984. Ever have that? And he won't let you forget it. And yes, what you did back in 1984 may have been wrong, but is God big enough to forgive your sins? I think so. You don't have to look back at that. You know, sometimes, I think, And this just needs to be said. I think sometimes some of us, we come to church and we do churchy things and we use what's called the language of Zion, which means that we can talk all the good church lingo. And we try to act a certain way, but we're not doing that because we're moving forward. We're doing that because of epic failure in our life. It's like we're trying to sometimes appease God, as if God was some sort of cultic deity who's always out to get us. And so we look the part. We say the right words. We put on the right mask. We do all the right things because we're trying to appease this God, because inside we feel like such epic failures.
We may learn.
But you don't have to do that. Why? Because Jesus has shown you that there is. Let me put it like this. Jesus has shown you what he really does think of you. What Jesus thinks about you was illustrated perfectly when he took up a cross. That's what Jesus thinks about you. I love this person. I choose to forgive. I choose to forget. Don't look back at the epic failure. Learn from them. Move forward by living backward, not looking backward, living backward. By following Christ. There's another reason. It's up there on the screen already. You've seen it. The leap of faith factor. Sometimes because of the leap of faith factor, we just keep looking back over our shoulder and plowing crooked. Now, what does that mean? Well, there's a theologian by the name of Soren Kierkegaard, great Danish name, lived back in the 1800s. He actually coined this phrase, leap of faith. Now, hang with me because we're about to get kind of deeper and deeper theological water here just for a moment, okay? We're going to dip our toe in. Then I've got a really cool illustration I want to show you about this. But he said that there's this gap between human finite understanding and God's nature. Yes, he's correct. There's this big gap, right? We don't understand everything about God. But he's shown us perfectly himself, God has in Jesus Christ, revealed perfectly. Jesus is the perfect revelation of God. So, we put our faith, we take a leap of faith, a leap of trust in believing that Jesus Christ is God. That's what we do essentially when we profess faith in Christ. We take a leap of faith that God in Jesus Christ is who he says he is and did what he says he did. We believe that. It is faith. But here's where it gets a little bit deeper. Kierkegaard said something that I really like before I fall off the stage here. I might take a leap of faith myself here in a minute. And this would prove his theory true. If I did that, it would be a leap of faith. But here's the thing. The object taking a leap of faith always fundamentally changes in its nature when it takes a leap of faith. Something about us fundamentally changes when we take a leap of faith. But sometimes we don't want to do that. Why? Jesus, I want to take a leap of faith, but I want good overnight accommodations on my mission trip, an air-conditioned and heated sanctuary, nice pews, a warm baptistry, great lighting, PowerPoint, band, good sound system. God, I'll follow you and take a leap of faith as long as I have that. Really? Jesus, I want to take a leap of faith, but my family. I need to go back and bury my father. Remember that story? It's right before this, by the way. Jesus, I need to take care of all the family business. I need to probate the will. I need to get my directives in order. I need to pay my taxes. I need to mow my grass because my weeds are really growing. It's early spring in West Texas, you know. Jesus, I want to take a leap of faith, but I have prior commitments. Yow. Really? What is Jesus saying? That's looking back. Plow straight by following me. Illustration. A cool one. This is really cool. I hope it works, what I'm about to show you. Yes. Now, pause it. Oh, well. Keep looking at it. Now, that looks kind of fuzzy. There was an object that flew across the screen. Right? Those of you living in radio, listening to radio, some of you may live there, I don't know, but we're showing a video here. There's a person who catapulted across the screen, took a leap of faith. There it is, one more time. This is instant replay right here. Now, I want to tell you who that is, because you know this person. She's actually sitting in the sanctuary right now. Her name is Betty Moore. Betty, can you stand up for just a minute? Okay, that's good. This is Betty Moore ziplining. Do you know what a zipline is? It's where basically a rope is holding you over the chaos of the deep below you, and you just take a leap of faith. And let me speak to you from experience as one who just tried this last youth camp. I did that. First time I ever ziplined. It was a leap of faith. And you fundamentally change in your nature when you take a leap of faith. Kierkegaard was right. Now, let me ask you this. If Betty Moore can zipline, you can follow Jesus Christ. You can follow Jesus Christ. It is a leap. You have to leave the past behind. Your epic failures, they don't have to define you. All the busyness and the stuff in your life, you can let Jesus transform all that and take it over. Let Him take over the schedule. You don't dictate to Jesus your to-do list. Let Jesus dictate it for you. He will do it. Oftentimes in ways that you can't see coming. But that's what makes Christianity fun. Am I right, Murph? Ask her. Sometimes, when you just say, okay, Jesus, here I am. Here we go. Feels like I'm about to take a zip line. He's got you. Are you trusting Him? Isn't it time for us to deal with our leap of faith factor? Cut the moorings of religiosity and spirituality that is a mile wide and an inch deep. Cut it off. Don't play the part. Anybody can show up to church on Sunday morning, but who's going to worship God 7 days a week? That's a leap of faith. Now there's one more thing that keeps us looking back sometimes. Well, actually, let me say this. There are some things that keep us looking forward. Let's move forward. How do you do that? Number one, you profess faith in Jesus Christ. That's where it starts. If you haven't done that, your leap of faith is to take Christ by the hand. that hand that's already reached down to you, profess faith in Christ. You say, well, Pastor, what does that really entail? I've said it before and I'll say it many other times. There's no magic mantra to it. You're not appeasing some cultish deity. Professing faith in Christ means saying, Jesus, I'm ready to surrender to you all that I have. All that I am, you've got it. I believe you are God. I want you in my heart. Have you done that? That's where it starts. Secondly, take a stand while you still have time. You want to plow straight? Take a stand while you have time. Back when I was in college, I was attending a church that they had a guest preacher one Sunday by the name of Jack Riddlehoover. How many of y'all have ever heard of him? He may have even preached here once every once in a while. He was a preacher for like 30 years at Pioneer Drive Church in Abilene. He was kind of the Gerald McBride of Abilene for a while. That's a great way to say that. He was guest preaching one Sunday morning, and this was, good night, 18, 20 years ago. But I still remember this. He talked about the time that we have to use, that God has given us to move forward in our lives. And he used an analogy of a clock, kind of like the one that we have in the back of the room. And every once in a while, he would get to preaching, and then during about 5 or 10 minutes would go by in his sermon, and he'd say, oh, look, it's 11:20. 10 more minutes have gone by for us to use our time for the Lord. Then he'd preach a little bit. He'd say, oh, it's 11:30 now. 10 more minutes have gone by. What have we done to reach somebody for Christ? The analogy went on and on and on. Minute after minute after minute is ticking by. What are we doing? How are we redeeming our time? Are we stuck thinking about the past? Are we thinking, well, preacher, I'm ready to get out of here. I got lunch plans today. What's so important that you're doing this week that you cannot witness to somebody? That you cannot speak a word of hope? That you cannot lift up an enemy in prayer? You still have time to do that. Even in these few moments, you have time. God himself in 2 Peter, through that great apostle, has said, I'm patient. Remember that? 2 Peter 3:9. God is patient, not wanting anyone to perish. God's not slow in keeping his promises, as we understand slowness. But God is patient, not wanting anyone to perish, but all to come to repentance. God is letting some of these minutes pass by right now, because he's being patient for somebody in this room to take a stand. For somebody in your sphere of influence to come to him. God is giving you minute by minute by minute. Are you taking a stand for him? Let me finish with this. And I especially want to direct this at students, but it goes to everybody. Back in 1995, in the church that I was going to, there was a guest preacher who came that day, and it was a Disciple Now weekend. And at that point in my life, I was really trying to think about what God wanted me to do with my life, all of those questions that many of us ask all the time. And he said something that struck me again this week. I still remember that, even though it was years ago. He said, the most dangerous prayer you can pray is, God, use me. The most dangerous prayer you can pray is, God, use me. But some of us want to just look back at our failures, at our past, and at all of our so-called priorities, and say, God, I want you to use me, but dot, dot, dot. Take that part out of the prayer. Just say, God, use me, period. Take a stand while you have time. Jesus said, anyone who takes that plow but looks back, you haven't really understood what the kingdom of God is all about yet. It ain't about looking back. It is about living backwards. But in living backwards, we actually move forwards. Move in the way of Jesus. Let's pray. God, we thank you for today and for this incredibly challenging word from the Scripture. Lord, you've called us to do extraordinary things. And so help us to take extraordinary leaps of faith. May today be the day that we look at our schedules and look at our pocketbooks and look at our time and look at our jobs and look at our neighbors and say, God, use me. Help us, Lord, to steer clear from these prayers that just keep us looking backwards. Like, God, use me, but on my time and my terms. I pray that we would surrender all that we have to you today. Help us, Lord, not only to do that individually, but as a church family. That the church would be more about the community of believers and less about individuals. More about personal commitment with a community focus. Looking for the good of the whole group, the body. Help us, Lord, to realize, as that church in Corinth had to realize that Paul was ministering to, that someone may be a hand in the body. Somebody may be an eye. Someone may be an arm. But every one of them has value and potential and usefulness. A body can't function if the whole body's not engaged or sees themselves as more worth than another part. Help us to move forward together with one heart and one voice, challenged to do the things of the kingdom and to live backwards in this world, but not look backwards. Not look behind us, but move forward by living your way, the way of the kingdom. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.